The October 28th, Planning and Zoning Commission meeting. Roll call.
David Castro.
Here.
Andrew Call.
Here.
Kevin Katz.
Here.
Here.
I think he said here.
Yeah, here.
Roger Rowling.
Here.
Gary Wright. Christina Atherton.
Here. Okay, an approval of the agenda. Is there any additions or deletions? If none, I'll take a motion.
So moved.
So moved by Kroll, seconded by Rowling. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. Agenda is approved. I will open up the floor to citizen comments for anyone who is present that would like to make a comment not related to the agenda. And seeing none in the audience, we will move on to the approval of the September 30th meeting minutes. Are there any corrections? If none, I'll take a motion.
I move to approve the minutes of September 30th, 2015 meeting.
Moved by Castro.
Second.
Second by Kroll. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Same sign if opposed. The minutes have been approved. Old business. We are continuing the review and adoption of the Planning and Zoning Commission bylaws and standing rules. Derek, do you have any comments on the city's behalf?
I believe we last considered this back in August with some thoughts for some changes. When we last discussed this, there were some questions that kept popping up that I was not quite prepared to answer. And so I've asked City Attorney Dean Frieders to attend tonight's meeting to field those questions and to kind of give an overview regarding some issues that have come up in the past. And so turn it over to Dean for review of the bylaws in Chapter 21.
Okay.
Madam Chair, I was asked to address a couple issues predominantly revolving around the presentation of witness testimony at hearings before the Plan Commission, and also some questions regarding the voting of the Plan Commission. With regard to the presentation of witnesses, different communities have different regulations. Under the Illinois Municipal Code, the chair of the Plan Commission has the authority to administer oaths without regard to whether the city has a specific ordinance. So if you have witnesses testifying, you would have the ability, or a chairman pro tem would have the ability, to swear in any witness if you deemed that necessary. Under Illinois case law, there's not a specific requirement that you actually do administer oaths, and courts have upheld Plan Commission hearings even in the absence of oaths. So that would be at the discretion of the commission as to whether or not that's required. Some plan commissions do have an ordinance process whereby they can require the attendance of witnesses and or subpoena witnesses. However, a plan commission itself doesn't have any independent law enforcement authority, and a plan commission subpoena for a witness is not something that we ordinarily would think the city could enforce through its police department, for example. So the process for enforcing a subpoena would have to be some sort of judicial process where we would ask a court to enforce a city ordinance for subpoenaing witnesses. And it's a somewhat indirect route to that outcome. And it would be challenging to see exactly how that process could work. We're unable to find any case law indicating that there's a circumstance where the Plan Commission would have an obligation to subpoena witnesses. And customarily, the burden would be on whomever is presenting evidence to the Plan Commission. And so it'd be their responsibility to bring in such testimony and evidence as they need to support whatever finding they're asking the Plan Commission to engage in. Fundamentally, I understand one of the questions was if the Plan Commission has any contempt authority with regard to a witness that's not cooperative. And ultimately, the authority that the Plan Commission has is to give credit or merit to testimony or to not give credit to it. As you're making a determination, you're reviewing the evidence that's presented to you, you're listening to what a witness indicates to you. If you find that their testimony isn't credible, or if they refuse to answer questions of the Plan Commission, it may be the case that you find their testimony to not be credible, or you give it less weight in your ultimate consideration, as compared to a witness who would be more forthright or who would be more open in answering or interacting with the Plan Commission. From time to time, the Plan Commission engages in what the case law would call a quasi-judicial role, where you're making a determination on an ultimate matter of how the facts apply, how the law applies to a given recommendation or a given decision of the Plan Commission. When you're acting in that kind of role, there is an obligation to permit cross-examination. To the extent that a public body such as a Plan Commission, or even for that matter a village board or city council, doesn't allow that cross-examination, the courts have very clearly held that that's a violation of the due process rights of people that participate in a hearing. So I know that the Plan Commission has been careful to address that, at least in the recent past, and to permit cross-examination where it's appropriate to do so. You can certainly limit the scope of that to information or facts that are relevant to the consideration before the Plan Commission, instead of getting into unrelated projects or unrelated matters. And if a party refuses to answer questions under cross-examination, then again, while it'd be challenging for the Plan Commission to have the legal authority to compel someone to answer questions, and likely impossible to do that without asking a court to intervene. The more direct route would be if a person presents testimony but then refuses to answer questions under cross-examination, not giving as much credit or not giving credit to the testimony that they're offering, and reflecting that in the record, that because they refuse to answer questions under cross-examination as they're required to do, that the Plan Commission doesn't have a choice but to give less credence to the testimony that they offer. So essentially, that is the greatest power that the Plan Commission has. You're ultimately forming your recommendation, you're forming your findings of fact, and you can craft those to reflect the testimony and the presentation before the Plan Commission. And as you find someone more or less credible, as they participate more voluntarily or less willfully in the process, you may determine that their testimony carries more or less weight in your ultimate determinations. Are there any questions on that topic before we move on to voting?
So the one question that I have in the bylaws, adding this line into our order of business, once we approve to add in the swearing in of persons to give testimony, mm-hmm. then we would need to do that at every meeting, correct? That there is
and
testimony? Or
If you're contemplating adding that, which you, again, you certainly have the authority to do it, and that's at the discretion of the Plan Commission, I would recommend that you do it consistently. So any meeting at which you're going to receive testimony in the format of a public hearing, that the testimony that's received be offered under oath.
So what if somebody walks in late, for example? I think we asked that last time. Mm-hmm. What if somebody walks in the room late? Are we doing it one by one as they come up? Or do we do it at the beginning, everybody stands up and says?
I think we had originally discussed to have it that way, but the same problem was if somebody comes in late, we'll have to swear them in up at the podium if we were to do it.
Individually.
Yeah.
So we'd have to do it individually.
After the beginning.
Afterwards. Yeah. So we kind of more or less have to keep tallies on them as they walked in at 6:01 post.
I think that those are each reasonable suggestions. If you do a mass swearing at the beginning and you make it clear to the public that the testimony that's being offered is under oath, we could supplement that with things like a sign at the podium, or periodically the chair could reflect that testimony being offered is under oath. And if you were not a part of the mass swearing, please consider yourself to be under oath. It's difficult to conceive of a circumstance where, assume we end up in litigation at some point, a court's going to come back and second guess and say, you missed swearing this one individual person under oath, and that's going to disqualify your entire proceedings. So I think, provided that you're using some reasonable and best efforts to accomplish the objective of getting everyone to testify under oath, particularly, and if this is a concern, we could incorporate into your bylaws that it is presumed that any person who testifies during a public hearing does so truthfully and under oath, and by participating, they are certifying that their testimony is truthful and under oath. We can do some things like that to buttress your position on that and try and ensure that you have a consistent proceeding.
I think what you've also heard from Attorney Frieders is that is not a requirement for our proceedings. we talked about it, that it sets a tone for how the process works, but the fact that we're not doing it today does not make any of your actions or any of their testimony null or void or invalid. So it is your choice to modify this however you see fit, but I would concur with Dean that whatever we do needs to be consistent. So if we're going to change that process, then we would certainly commit to doing so.
Then addressing the question of voting, the bylaws of the Planning and Zoning Commission reflect that the affirmative vote of at least 4 members is required to pass any motion, and that a vote of fewer than 4 members is only sufficient to adjourn a meeting. So a majority of a quorum, 3 of 4 of you, would not be adequate to pass a recommendation with regard to a consideration before the Planning and Zoning Commission. In the ordinary course, in the absence of that provision, the applicable rule would be that a majority of a quorum of you are adequate to pass a motion before the Planning and Zoning Commission. You have this Planning and Zoning Commission specific regulation. It is my understanding that in the past, the bylaws have been referred to the City Council for approval. To the extent that you're making changes to them, it'd be my recommendation that we go through that process again to give them the force of a city ordinance, and then they would become a procedure that the city would follow. The city is somewhat unique as a home rule municipality, as many municipalities in the state are. There is some case law indicating that even if the city fails to follow its own internal procedures, that as long as the ultimate decision that's reached supports the applicable zoning factors and is a reasonable zoning decision and isn't arbitrary or capricious, that the decision may still be enforceable. However, it would always obviously be our recommendation that if you adopt a procedure, that you intend to follow it and that you follow it as closely as you can.
So does that answer the questions that anybody had about the voting piece? I know that was one topic that we had.
So in short, you're not required to have that provision. If you seek to have it, the 4 votes required, then I'd recommend that be endorsed by the City Council and that you follow it to the extent you can.
This provision has been here for some time. I mean, this is not a new provision, correct?
That's correct. And again, it's our understanding that these were once previously approved by the City Council.
So I see a commission now that is composed of 5 individuals. If we were to vote on a motion today, and the majority will be 3, would that be forgetting the content, so ignoring the content of the motion right now, if we were to pass that 3-2, would that be an approved motion?
So this is in your current bylaws, and I'm assuming that they've been previously approved by the City Council. What this indicates is that it would require, going to the item on your docket for later this evening, if you're going to approve a recommendation with regard to a proposed special use permit, that would be something that would require a vote of 4 of you in favor to approve a recommendation. If you failed to have tonight a 4-1 vote, the consequence of that would be, under this language, it would be treated as a negative recommendation or a denial. So that is how it's currently drafted. And again, our understanding, going back and trying to do a little bit of reconstruction, is that these were previously approved by the City Council, so they would be the rules that are in effect at present.
Within standard OMA quorum rules, isn't that generally how it goes?
In the ordinary course, a motion by a public body, unless there's some specific rule that applies because of a unique circumstance, in the ordinary course, a motion requires a majority of a quorum. So it would not require.
So it wouldn't require 4 out of 5.
That's correct.
So we're kind of treating this special by having a 4 out of 5.
It enhances the vote requirement necessary to approve a positive recommendation, and that's why it's specifically called out. So to answer your question directly, if that last paragraph wasn't there, mm-hmm. and you had a 3-2 vote tonight, that would be a vote to pass.
Yeah. Recollecting back to the OMA training, and I recall, I believe if you have a group of 7, you reach quorum with 5, a 3-2 would pass in standard quorum rules.
This precedes that.
That's correct, so we're just trying to figure out if we want that or not.
Discussion by anybody else on that? Matt brings up a good point.
I mean, in any case, I always look at what the standard practice and best practices are. If there's no reason to deviate from it, I don't see a reason to do it. That being said, I'm not going to raise a stink if people on this committee are more comfortable having a majority of four, which would be the majority in the case of a full commission, to have it be that. I'm just trying to clarify my own. So.
And we did run into a situation one time, maybe 2 years ago, I think it was, where we met quorum, but the vote, I can't remember how that went. There were four of us, but the vote was 3-1, I think, or something. There was some odd thing.
Where you had four members present and three voted in favor and one voted against.
Yes.
And that would not successfully pass the recommendation.
Correct.
Well, yeah.
And we actually ended up bringing that back, I think, because there was confusion or we weren't sure about the quorum aspect of. But in general, quorum terms, we could have, it would have been fine.
Yeah.
Because we had met quorum.
It's the majority of the majority. It's the minimal majority.
Right, right.
So if you do determine to keep it in, it would be advisable to, certainly anytime you have new members, and perhaps even more often than that, to periodically review your bylaws and reacquaint yourself with your voting rules so that you're sure that everybody is operating under the same assumptions.
Thank you. Does anyone have any other questions for Dean or clarification that we need?
And certainly if there are from time to time, or if you have other questions, feel free to contact Derek or I, or we're always happy to meet with you or come to a planning commission meeting and address any issues before the commission.
Thank you. So do we, is there any, I don't know how to go forward.
So you
want us to try and make a decision this evening, or we need to decide if we need to review it a little bit further, bring it back at the next meeting? Do you all approve the changes?
I'm fine with them. Do we need to vote on it?
Official adoption, mm-hmm. I think, yeah.
You can go tonight.
I'm fine with that.
I do confess my desire to think about this a little bit more. I think now it is clear. I guess I need to think what the consequences are going in one direction versus the other, unless I guess right now I don't feel ready to articulate what the pros and cons are for one way or the other, unless one of you are willing to offer a list of those pros and cons. I mean, I see the benefits of one direction, going in one direction versus the other in that particular last paragraph on the four votes to pass something.
So you're saying you like that better?
No, I say that I don't know how I feel about going in one way or the other.
Oh.
Well, I think one con could be if we have a situation where we have something that the majority of the people present are very passionate about approving or not approving, and then you have we have a quorum to have a meeting, but we don't have a quorum to make that vote, mm-hmm. but yet we voted and it doesn't end up being the vote that we would hope, you know.
Well,
that's one con.
If you have four, you just have to have the understanding that you have to be unanimous.
Right, exactly.
But everyone have to always know that.
Right.
I mean, it really comes down to the strength of the vote and the strength of the recommendation that goes to the city council.
Right.
And having that in there gives strength to the vote, strength to the message.
And I will use, the University Village discussion and item that came to us, and it could have turned a different way if we hadn't had that enough people, enough to make that four vote. There is always that possibility. So it could have gone a different way than it did. Just something to think about. I am fine for waiting to the next meeting if we want to wait. I'm fine with going forward if we want to go forward.
Seems like the major thing is the voting and quorum. What, is there any other thoughts on the other piece? What was that regarding again? Sorry.
The swearing in.
The swearing in, yeah.
To give testimony. Right now, it's under 3.5, working it into the agenda. Adding it under citizen comments before we start old business.
My inclination, my personal inclination is not to have that part in. And the reason for that, I kind of gave a preamble last time that we addressed this topic, that is that without any enforcement associated with it, I'm afraid that is going to be just symbolic. At the same time, I do recognize that the symbols have power. I wouldn't second the idea that we need it at this level. I think it may be a different story if we were a city council, but we're not that. That's my general position.
I agree. I mean, it's not going to have any impact on our decision one way or the other. And to try to follow that rule every single time seems kind of nonsensical.
And also, it's pronounced citizen comments. Comments are not held to truth by nature of the fact that they're comments and opinions. So, and most of the commentary we hear are frankly, well, opinions. So, I don't know, I'm with you too. I don't know, Roger, what do you think?
Well, I think it may cause people who tend to stretch the truth to think twice about it. Should I stretch it that far? So, for that reason, I'm in favor of the swearing in.
I'm a little concerned that it may sway people from the public hearings, from giving their, even though they are opinions, giving some of their opinion during that public hearing process. That could be pretty important for us to know, or for, you know, something maybe we haven't thought about. But I could go either way.
So what if we vote 3-2 now? It's not going to matter, right?
What I'm seeking is direction. What I can bring back is language that what I'm hearing is a majority of your group indicating I can bring back to the next meeting these changes in here, and hopefully we will have all seven of you present to have that considered and discussed before adoption.
When you say bring it back?
I would make the amendment to omit, based upon what I'm hearing, the swearing in portion. And I would also remove the language regarding four votes. That's what I think I'm hearing from the body. But again, I will let you share with me your intentions.
So from, first of all, thank you very much, Attorney Frieder, for the clarifications. From my perspective, I think things are clearer now. I cannot imagine what the question will be in the future or now. If there are no other questions, my strong inclination, and I may be willing to move, assuming, you know, depending on the feedback, to postpone our vote on this until our next meeting. And my explicit question to the rest of the group is, do we have any other questions regarding clarification on this bylaws? If not, then I don't know if I need to move to postpone this.
But it will require four votes.
Yes, yes. And now that is something that now I understand.
That today.
Now I understand that. So I move to postpone this vote on the bylaws until our next meeting.
So moved by Mr. Katz. Is there a second?
Castro.
Castro, sorry. that sea cape.
Well, she said you motioned it, so you want some.
I'm not seconding it.
I did clarify, or re-clarify, it was Mr. Castro. Do we have an amendment to the motion then? Or a strike of the motion?
It would appear as though the motion failed for lack of a second, so the floor would be open.
You know, my inclination is if the people show up that night, it's a majority vote, it should go through. You know, I don't see why we should push it through to the next week or couple weeks until.
And hope that we have enough people.
And hope that person shows up, you know.
Oh, that's not my motivation, by the way. My motivation is to think about it. That's all.
I'm gonna echo some of what Adam said. The people who make decisions are the ones who show up. I've sat on other boards and observed many, and the standard OMA quorum laws have applied to them, and there's been no specialty clause for members of seven. So I frankly will just come out and say this. I would be comfortable with striking language regarding four members being required to pass. A three or four would be fine in such case of that being a quorum. Additionally, the swearing in language in entirety being removed. That's where I'm sitting right now. I don't know how other people feel. I know Roger, I'm not trying to get oppositional. I know you had mentioned support. And I get the general premises. It's great to get people's minds and some seriousness, but at the same time, I really respected what you said too about that intimidating people to make it feel like a court trial and they'll be less motivated to get up and talk, although maybe that's not such a bad thing sometimes either. Anywho, that's just kind of where I'm sitting right now. I'm comfortable with striking both of those pieces of language from the bylaws. Should I make a motion?
Sure, go for it.
Okay, I guess I can, help me out here, Derek, but make a motion to adopt the bylaws as they are with the recommendations, with the additional recommendations to remove an affirmative vote of at least four members to commission to be required to pass. Of subcase being the quorum meeting four, three would be acceptable. Additionally, striking all language regarding swearing in and of citizen commentary.
So a motion's been made by Mr. Kroll.
I'll second.
Seconded by Mr. Katz. Any discussion?
Can I abstain?
You certainly can abstain. Under typical parliamentary procedure, an abstention counts with the majority.
It counts with the majority.
Yes. Whichever
you can
way
vote
that
against
falls.
The motion too. Won't hurt my feelings.
No, that's fine.
I guess just some further commentary on that. I make that motion just because it seems like a feeling of moving forward. This is fairly comfortable, and if people aren't, then it's fine.
I actually am okay with striking the words, that paragraph about the voting, because I would hate for us to be in a situation where we're ready to vote. There's only four of us present, and then we waver back and forth on the vote and carry it to the next meeting just because we aren't really sure if we're going to have the majority of four, and then all we're coming here for the next meeting is to vote. I just, out of respect for people's time, and but I also take that into consideration that it's the decision that we're making to move forward to the city council as well. But I keep that piece in the retrospective of people's time and hoping that this could, delay a vote where we'd have to come back one meeting for 10 minutes just to vote. So I'm also striking that paragraph, I think is a good idea.
I'm okay with it going either way on the issue of a quorum or the idea of just saying a majority. We've done it for a lot of years where you had to have four people to have the proposal approved. However, I think the argument was made here that if you've got only four people, every one of us that are in attendance would have to vote in favor of it to accept it. And then, you know, based on that, I'm leaning toward the idea that if we have a simple majority, that it should be an acceptable way of getting the motion approved.
You good?
Okay.
Okay. Do we have to do roll call, or are we a nay?
I'll do roll call. Track it easier. Yeah.
Okay.
So, Castro?
Abstain.
Kroll?
Yes.
Katz?
Yes.
Ruling?
Yes.
Chair Atherton?
Yes.
Motion passes.
It will continue to be our approach here. Now that they've been approved by the Plan Commission, we will take them to the City Council and ask the City Council for approval of them, just out of an abundance of caution then.
And when is that next meeting? Do you know?
They would not make the meeting on November 9th. It would be at the next meeting thereafter, which 23rd. Would be November 23rd.
So if we happen to have a meeting prior to November 23rd, we would still have to go by our current bylaws because they have not, these have not been adopted by the City Council yet, correct? So, and I'm just asking for so we mm-hmm. have clarification of the vote piece of it. If so, currently our current bylaws are as is with the vote item, and until these are approved by City Council, we have to stay with those bylaws, the current bylaws, correct?
That would be the conservative read, and with that excellent point being made, Chair, as staff, we can work and see if it's possible to avoid that uncertainty for you and get these on the November 9th agenda, but okay. It'll be the 9th or the 23rd.
But if not, it would be that.
That'd be the conservative okay. approach, yes.
And so would we be notified of that prior to our next meeting if it is before the 23rd?
Regarding your next meeting would be on Veterans Day, and okay. we will not be having a meeting on Veterans Day, so
okay.
unless there is a need for a special meeting between now and then, I don't foresee
then
that occurring.
Then we're good to go. Okay, great. Thank you. Okay. So I move on to new business and a request. Thank you, Dean, very much. A request by Verizon. Oh, I'm sorry. By Ray Schinkel of Insight RE Inc. on behalf of Verizon Wireless for a special use permit. To co-locate Verizon communication equipment on top of the existing 63-foot-tall bank building located at 155 North 3rd Street in DeKalb, which is zoned Central Business District. Opening comments, Derek?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Tonight, Matthew Grant, not Ray Schinkel, is here from Insight RE. Matthew will give a brief PowerPoint presentation depicting what it is that they want to co-locate on top of that old bank building that is 63 foot tall or five stories in height. Within the Central Business District, there are a couple of unique circumstances that this particular application falls within. So one would think a co-location of cellular equipment would be in violation of the height limit requirements in our typical zoning districts. Within the Central Business District, this particular building plus antenna and structure of the faux penthouse design would be underneath that maximum height capacity. So some of the things I thought were going to be a challenge and issue when we started getting into this does currently meet code. In the staff report, you see the analysis done by staff for the application before you. At your seats this evening, you have received updated construction documents and updated elevations showing existing view sheds with proposed penthouse structure on the top of those. The petitioner and the applicant has provided that in response to the staff report that was sent to you. But I don't want to steal any of their, or any of Matt's thunder, so without further ado, I'll be happy to answer questions thereafter and go over the conditions of approval upon conclusion of his presentation.
Okay, so at this moment, I will open the public hearing so that I don't forget to do that. And if you'd like to come to the podium and state your name, your location.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for having me. My name is Matthew Grant with Insight RE Inc., and I'm here on behalf of Verizon Wireless. And I'm here regarding Verizon's proposal to install a new antenna facility at 155 North 3rd Street. Verizon is one of the top carriers in the country, and through this proposed site, they are looking to use the site towards their push to provide seamless coverage in this area and also to improve their in-building and in-vehicle coverage in the area. To begin, I just wanted to go over a few things regarding the ever-growing demand for wireless communications. Clearly, it's becoming more and more common. Cell phone usage is becoming more and more common throughout everyone across all ages. But back in 2006, that was the first year that the amount of minutes used on wireless phones surpassed those minutes used on landlines. And also 90% of US households are using wireless phones. And this is, you know, ever growing, given the capabilities of what cell phones can do nowadays, because it's much more than call and text. It's internet, email, apps, everyday usage. And due to this, many households are now cutting their landlines as well. Also, cell phone usage is becoming increasingly vital to public safety. According to the FCC, over 70% of 911 calls are made from wireless phones. Also, 40% of children ages 12 to 14 and over 50% of Americans over the age of 65 own a cell phone, and primarily for the reasons of safety. Finally, E911 ensures that 911 calls are routed to the appropriate emergency dispatcher. They also provide a call back number and confirm the location of the distressed phone call. Now, I'd like to move along with, I guess, the process in determining a candidate. And it begins with what we call the release of a search ring. So the search ring is determined by radio frequency or RF engineers. These are network engineers who help design these sites. And they're constantly evaluating their network to find the areas, you know, where an improvement of coverage is needed. And they also work closely with their sales and marketing teams to find out where customers are complaining or demanding better service. This particular ring is called DeKalb 3. And this DeKalb 3 is under consideration to provide adequate relief to the area to the southeast of Northern Illinois University. And it will also improve the in-building and in-vehicle coverage along Illinois 38 Lincoln Highway. And like I said, the in-building coverage in the area. So what I have now is what the radio frequency engineers have generated. This is a coverage map of Verizon's coverage in DeKalb, particularly with their four existing sites. And then the next slide is where this proposed site is going. As you can see, it's centrally located to the four existing sites, and it provides that increased coverage in that central area along Lincoln Highway. So I'll go back again. That is Verizon's current coverage without the DeKalb 3 site that is proposed. And this is Verizon's coverage with the proposed DeKalb 3 site. And then those four sites that are listed on the coverage map are these following four sites that are, you know, spread throughout DeKalb. So when a ring is released, in this case the DeKalb 3 ring, the site acquisition process begins by members of, you know, my firm at Insight, and the when you first begin your search, especially in areas with, you know, particularly or particular ordinances, and obviously in an area that is, you know, developed, you're always looking for existing structures, whether that be an existing tower, a potential rooftop, water tank, you know, anything you can co-locate these antennas on to get the height that you're needed, that is needed. And then the three main items for criteria is, are they in the actual ring, you know, the search area that we're looking for? Can they provide the height to obtain that coverage? Would it pass structurally? Obviously, that needs to be proven so it, you know, can sustain. And is the owner of that structure or property interested in leasing? This is obviously the Central Business District, as Derek noted, that is, this building is located in the Central Business District. So now I'm moving along to the actual proposed site of 155 North 3rd Street. On the screen is an aerial view of the building and the rooftop that Verizon is proposing to install this antenna facility on. Our architect and engineer who worked along with us on this project was able to complete some photo simulations. I believe you were provided some, but we can go over them on the screen as well. So this is the photo simulation from the intersection of East Locust Street and North 2nd Street. And this is approximately 315 feet to the building. So this is what the building currently looks like, obviously without the proposed Verizon installation. And this is what the building will look like afterwards. As you can see, you know, we worked very closely with city staff in the city of DeKalb to create a facility that would not only get our coverage objective and allow the equipment to be installed, but also something that would not be visually obtrusive. And because of this, we are utilizing a stealth design, which is what you guys see on top of the roof. The equipment is located behind that. It's a stealth reinforced fiberglass panels that allow the signal to come through, but also can hide the equipment. Our next photo simulation is from next to the Egyptian Theater on North 2nd Street. And this one's approximately 375 feet from the building. So this is before, you know, as is, and this is afterwards with the proposed Verizon installation on top. So that's before and after again. And then our third and final photo simulation is from the parking lot at the intersection of East Locust Street and North 3rd Street. This photo simulation is approximately 350 feet from the building. This is before with the building as is, and this is a photo simulation of you know, the facility with the proposed, you know, penthouse looking stealth design. So before and after. And then these are cutouts from the construction drawings that we did send over that were updated by our architect and engineer. As you can see, the penthouse will be located on top of the roof. There will be an antenna installation of three different arrays, and each array will have three antennas. So in total, nine antennas are proposed to be installed. Given these different, you know, these nine different antennas and the different tilts that they can be installed with, it'll create a full, you know, coverage supplement to the existing coverage in the area. And then all of the associated equipment that connect with the antennas will be installed with the antennas behind the stealth screening. This is just a zoom in. You could see the placement of the antennas, but like I said, you won't be able to see any of the equipment from, you know, unless you were inside of that stealth paneling. And then this is the building profile, which obviously shows the elevations, as Derek discussed earlier, in that, you know, kind of notes how tall the building will, or the penthouse will be on top of the building. And then finally, one thing Verizon does pride themselves on, they have, propose backup power for every single site that they install. This is obviously in emergency situations, or if the power goes out, you know, this site will still be up and running. For this site, the backup power is proposed to be a generator in the parking lot to the southwest of the building. It'll be on that asphalt parking lot along that wall, as shown in this photo that is also included in the construction drawings. Like I said, this is something they pride themselves on, and they always want their sites to be functioning, even if it's, you know, some sort of natural disasters going on or an emergency situation or if the power's out. So I went and took some photos of this proposed area. So it'd be that area along the building on the asphalt parking lot. So that's one view, and here's a second view, you know, of that area between the arrow and the side of the building on that asphalt parking lot. So that's kind of all I have for the presentation. This is just our zoning application that was submitted, that we've been working on, like I said, with the City of DeKalb staff. But overall, Verizon feels that they have a strong candidate that not only meets your ordinance and the, you know, the height restriction, but also is something that can really serve the area, you know, of which it's looking to provide the coverage, and not be visually obtrusive.
Thank you for that presentation. I do have, I'm going to open up the questions with this one. The picture that's actually on the screen right now, I had a question about.
Okay.
Can you confirm, so the generator, approximately how big would this be? Like, what is the actual view that we would see from this view of the generator?
Okay, so in the construction drawings, it gives the fencing details. It would be a 10-foot by 14-foot fence. That would be the lease area for the generator. The generator would be placed inside of there. It would be about, we're proposing an 8-foot fence for security reasons, and I understand that your ordinance does recommend that it be a covered fence as well, so if that's something that needs to be done, that can be done as well.
So it would be placed totally on the asphalt? It wouldn't go up at all on the sidewalking here?
No, it would not. It would be in that. So I know this is on the construction drawings as well, and I know that it's a, you know, the black lines are showing where it's proposed, and it's obviously drawn on the asphalt, so it's difficult.
Okay.
But yeah, it's hard to see on the screen, I guess.
So looking at this picture then, let's take the, so there are currently parking spaces there. Would it take up any of those parking spaces?
Per our discussions with the landlord, it would not, because
okay,
the angled parking spaces go in a different angle coming back, so that corner is actually currently unused by parking.
Okay, so it would go where that corner piece is that there's no parking.
Yeah, so it kind of forms a triangle, but the different diagonals.
Okay. So there wouldn't be any hindrance to people driving through that drive-through, no hindrance on parking, not really any blocking that sidewalk area, so people could still
correct
utilize that area.
Correct.
Okay.
And I just wanted to correct myself. It's a 10 by 16, not a 10 by 14.
Okay.
Actually, that was going to be my question. 10 by 16 is the area?
Is the fenced in area.
So it doesn't take any more than 10 by 16?
Correct. Verizon has their standard backup generators that they use, and that's the space that is needed.
The generator, how many feet is the distance from the edge of the generator to the next nearest building?
Well, I guess it's proposed to go right along that building in the photo. That's actually...
I mean, does it set right tight up against the building, or is it in an island all to itself?
It's proposed to be set right up against the building.
It is, okay.
Yeah, so if you look on the construction drawing, page C-1. Obviously, it shows the installation of the bank building where the site is proposed. And then to the bottom left, it shows the generator lease area going right along that existing building to the southwest.
The connections for the generator, I'm assuming, would be run underground?
Yes, and then up to the site.
And up to the site, okay. Will it go into the basement of that building next to it at all, or it'll strictly be from the basement of the bank building over and under over to the generator?
Well,
it shouldn't.
As shown on this drawing, which in the construction drawings, it's towards the back. It's E-4. I believe it's the fifth page to the back. It shows that, you know, the generator will be placed there, yeah, and then across the parking lot will be the proposed route for buried conduits for the emergency power, which would go into the bank building, which is in the bottom left of that picture.
So that's kind of what that black line?
Yes.
That would be the following of it? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Are there any other questions at the moment for Mr. Grant? I'm going to note that we have no public in the room, so I'm assuming there will be no public comment. I will offer that ability, but there's no one here. So we can go into discussion. And Derek, I have a question about, there were some items that I think were of concern in regard to this. I'm just looking back in the backup real quick. One of those items, I believe, maybe was the fence that we need to discuss and landscaping. Is that?
So if you look at the sample motion on page 6 of 7 of the staff report, as I've gone through and checkboxed each of those, I think the remaining ones that is before you this evening that I don't know if we've achieved resolution will be on items 5, 6, and 7.
Okay. But everything else is?
I think we can certainly accomplish, and I talked to the applicant today, and the only one I think that we may have some challenges with is the landscaping, but.
I'm kind of thinking that as well.
To that end, yes, 5, 6, and 7.
Okay. How tall is the generator itself, roughly, and the equipment that would go with it that would be behind the fence?
Unfortunately, I don't have that specific answer right now.
It's not like taller than 4.
No.
It looks like about 4.
Yeah, the only reason why the 8-foot fence is proposed is for security reasons.
Okay.
It wouldn't be much more than, yeah, okay, a couple, 3 or 4 feet.
Okay.
We have the language crafted in here for item number 6 to be a site-proof fence of at least 6. So, Derek, would you just kind of leave that to the discretion of the petitioner to be somewhere between 6 and 8, or?
The minimum requirement is 6, so it could be 8. Yes.
Okay.
I'm glad that you're thinking of 8, thinking of the, yeah, the security.
Correct.
Purposes, yeah, especially in that area.
And Derek, the generator site, the fence that is showing in the print here shows that it's 6 inches from the property line.
Mm-hmm.
And that's acceptable in a general commercial area?
We're typically not going to see fences in the central business district, but in this particular case, technically speaking, this would work for the fence location. I think what we're going to have a challenge with is the requirement for landscaping. Mm-hmm. Yeah. 6 inches from the fence to the property line does not give a lot of ability or detail to add landscaping if that's the choice of the Planning and Zoning Commission. This might require some thinking outside of the box.
It just looks at eyeballing it like landscaping would not bode well for this, because it's got concrete next to parking, so you're going to have maintenance of landscaping that would abut next to somebody trying to park a vehicle.
Right.
So.
That, or it's going to take a parking place space out and maybe some walking space out and.
It's, landscaping just doesn't seem logical in this spot.
Maybe ivy.
Yeah, maybe, yeah, something extremely light that would like crawl the base or something.
Was there a question, I thought I read this, but now I'm not finding it very easily. Was there a question about the roof, is the rooftop going to be fully encapsulated, like there won't be any open spaces?
No, that is correct. There was a, on our original proposal, one of the sides of it, of the four sides, for access reasons, had a gap in it just to be able to access into it for the technicians. And to accommodate the city's request of being, you know, as least obtrusive as possible, we closed that gap.
Okay. How, what is the access to that area? Is it, so I'm assuming there would be a door on one of those? How do you get to
an access to the
roof?
To the penthouse that's proposed?
Right.
So it was proposed to be an open gap, you know, that you'd be able to climb a small ladder into.
Okay.
Given that it, you know, it was a recommendation to close it, so you're not looking at it and can just see a gap in the middle of it, there's now a door there.
Okay.
So there'd be a small ladder, swing open the door. And
okay. So there's no entrance coming up out of the roof that would go into there that you'd have to worry about?
Oh, no. Yeah, so the access to the roof's through the building and then from the building into the proposed penthouse.
Okay, thank you. Okay. Any other questions, discussion? We need to probably.
Yeah, the antenna that are located inside of this enclosure, how many feet is it from the surface that you'd be standing on to the bottom of the antenna that are mounted inside of that enclosure?
Well, so the center line of the antenna is 79 feet. The antennas vary from 6 to 8 feet, so it would be anywhere from 73 to 74 feet.
No, I meant from, if I'm standing on the roof.
Oh, the building, on the roof. Sorry, I thought you meant on the ground.
And I'm looking at your antenna. How many feet is the lowest point of the antenna?
Let me, I'm just checking the elevation page.
I guess what I'm getting at is, like in winter time, if we get 2 feet of snow and it's going to be windy and it starts swirling and we start getting a buildup in your enclosure, is that going to affect your performance of your antenna?
It would not, because so when a site is designed, they try to eliminate all blocking, which is, so an antenna works, imagine if you took a flashlight and put it upside down and turned it on, the higher it goes, the more spread out it gets.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason why they're elevated within that penthouse is if they were just on the roof area, when that signal spreads, when it comes out of the antenna, it would just be going straight into the roof. So it wouldn't make it out. So that's why they are elevated.
It's about 8 feet up, Roger.
Okay.
I was going to say, it's not exactly noted, but that's what it appears to be.
Yeah, not likely we'll get a snowbank that high on the roof.
Never know.
You never know. I've seen it.
Yeah.
Say, with the wind blowing like it was when I was driving down 88 today, I think there's a good chance.
Yeah. Okay. Discussion about the landscaping. I agree with Matt. There's really not any place. I hate to, like, take a parking space out, because I know parking is really limited in that area. I hate to think about taking a chunk out of that sidewalk area and beat up that brick that has been laid down. What are your guys' thoughts about? So foregoing landscaping or an alternative or?
I think like a brick or a faux brick and some ivy that was suggested would look nice down there. It's pretty maintenance free.
So then along with that.
I don't know if that would affect the janitor.
Yeah, along with that, we'd also have to think like what kind of fencing too. I mean, the conversation kind of goes hand in hand.
Would it be like the enclosure that we have the fast food chains put their dumpsters in?
Yeah.
I would think so.
Something like that.
And I really dislike the thought of wood just because it adds to that extra maintenance expense.
Mm-hmm.
I tend to like to lean towards vinyl or something that's a little easier to maintain. But if you're going to do an ivy, I don't know how well that will stick to the vinyl or grow up the vinyl.
Well, depending on what kind of fencing material you do, vine can cause damage after
yes.
time, and it requires maintenance to keep it halfway decent looking, which would then require that facility to do such. I would just stand by what I said originally. I think this is just one of those times where landscaping in entirety is going to have to be omitted, just unless somebody else strongly agrees. But that, just when you stare, when you just look at E4 at the bottom right picture, and you look at it, like landscaping just isn't feasible there.
And there's actually pretty good landscaping already in
yeah.
that area.
I mean, if you look to the right, yeah. So,
might I offer a suggestion?
Please.
So in the staff backup, this page where there's the four pictures provided by the applicant in the original packet that went out. The intent of the landscaping is to reduce the measured or perceived impact upon public rights of way or residential properties. And right across this bricked sidewalk that is landscaped to an area known as the Van Buren Plaza, from staff's perspective, that is the public area in this sense. So might, as I'm picking up on some of the things that the Planning Zoning Commissioners are indicating, might it make sense to not try to fence it, but somehow mimic a brick? You've heard the applicant tonight indicate that they would alter the chain link fence that was proposed with something different. Maybe it makes sense that this out accessory structure match the building it's adjacent to and not the one that it's coming to, given its proximity to that, as an alternative. Do you follow what I'm saying? So if you look at the picture there, clearly the bank building is more of a white structure with vertical brown lines going for the base all the way up to the rooftop. The penthouse will be of similar color of a lighter material. When you look at that, what appears to be a limestone material or a beige brick, maybe there's a material out there that matches that that doesn't stand out as much as a chain link fence. Because at the end of the day, we still want to muffle or attenuate the noise that would perhaps be measured at the property line. So that decibels, I don't know how long or how often or how frequent the generator runs. It's only there for emergencies, but if you have to test it once a month to ensure it starts when you want it to, those are some of the other things to consider and contemplate, because it is next to the theater building there.
So it would be more or less to use the same enclosure material that would be used on the top to fence the antenna to use down around the generator? Or is that oversimplifying it?
I don't know that you'll have the color match, but I think you're on the right track. So I guess as I'm planning from my seat listening to the conversation, I don't know if there is a material out there that would meet the security requirements for Verizon, but also meet the noise attenuation. So if it is I hear Commissioner Katz indicate, like people do with a dumpster enclosure. So that's usually a split face block enclosure. You have an example that's 200 feet away at the dumpster enclosure in the Van Buren Plaza. That's a split block with a limestone cap.
Yep.
Now, that's overkill for a dumpster or a emergency generator, but maybe there is a material out there that looks more like the material of the building next door than it does for the one that it's coming from, to try to minimize and make it appear as though it belongs there and it's not standing out.
Unlike the porta potty?
Yeah. So having that would more or less, having some sort of faux, you know, building style material would more or less take care of items 5, 6, and 7 by providing a solid material that requires no landscaping and would attenuate noise.
That's a possibility. I'm trying to think outside the box with you, with the applicant at the podium, not putting pressures on anyone, but, you know, the other solution was, can this emergency generator go on the secondary roof? I don't know that answer.
I'd be comfortable with that. Either one, the first one that we were talking about.
That we don't have to worry about it. But again,
right.
I'm sure it costs money to do so, but I don't want any regret to be, we didn't explore all options.
Right. We can always take the ivy from that building and move it over to.
There you go.
I mean, fence and landscaping's maybe a bit cheaper than some basic material that could enclose it. I don't know.
Right.
I mean, I'm not an architect, so.
Yeah, I wouldn't be able to speak to that.
But I would think you're going to probably invest a fair amount in that, too. And you're going to have to maintain it, whereas a faux wall that matched the building material would be one and done and take care of all of those things and require no further maintenance.
Mm-hmm. Will there be some type of buffering up against that building between the generator to help with the noise at all?
The building that's shown in that photo?
Correct, that the generator will be up against.
I don't think there's any in particular that is proposed.
Okay. I think it's going to be right up next to it.
So I'm just thinking of the people in that building.
Oh.
And currently what that building is used for those that don't know, is a cosmetology school. So when you're in there, you know, they're in there performing services that are supposed to be relaxing and, you know, calming a little bit. And I can just imagine all of a sudden a generator go off and you're in the middle of a pedicure trying to relax. I was just wondering, like, what will the noise on the inside of that building be like with the generator? Is just what I'm thinking. Or if it goes back to a theater, if there's a movie going on and the generator happens to kick in or has to kick in or whatever.
Right.
What is that noise going to sound like on the inside of that building since the generator's up close to the building?
Right, and I completely understand that concern.
And I've been in that building before, and you can hear the train once in a while, and so just thinking out loud.
Doesn't the generator only go off during emergencies?
It should.
So I know.
So people aren't probably going to be relaxing.
If all the electricity has gone out, well, everybody would be in there, yeah.
Kind of,
but I'm thinking of, like, when they're testing it or, you know, if they have to test it.
Right, so what Derek said earlier was correct. It would obviously only be used in emergency situations. But that being said, they would, you know, like to test it. And it's usually of the frequency of, like, a maximum of once per month. So that's what you can expect.
Okay.
We don't know the decibel level.
No, so I saw that as a comment. I can't honestly speak to the specific decibel level. I do know that Verizon proposes to deploy these on almost every site, and they're throughout the state. And the generators that they use do abide by all state and county noise level laws.
Any other comments, questions, thoughts, ideas?
So have you been around one of these generators when it is operating?
I could not tell you that I have, no. I have not.
You have not?
I have not, no.
Okay, so at this point, I'm going to close the public hearing. Um, and ask if anybody is ready for a motion or if we need more discussion.
Why don't you move what you said earlier?
Me?
What you said earlier.
Well, and just help me out a little as I graph this, Derek. So essentially, a lot of what we discussed is more or less of the eight amendments to the special use permit to grant to the petitioner. We have more or less talked about striking the language of items 5, 6, and 7 that indicate to put in landscaping, install a site-proof fence, and then installing buffering equipment all respectively. In substitute for those, to investigate the implementation of some sort of wall-like material that would match the building and provide for all three of those. Am I correct in understanding everywhere we've gone so far?
I think that would meet the intention of code. As long as at the end of it, we can still say it provides security, it provides, it minimizes the perceived impact of the public rights of way, and it meets the needs for the decibel level at the property line. I think all three would theoretically be meant by what you described.
Okay. So should it be more or less crafted with the approval of the city as it observes this potential wall coming together, something to that extent? Because I assume you'd be along for the ride. So that's being implemented or not?
We would be involved in the building permit part of it.
Okay.
I think for your recommendation to the city council, though, perhaps vet out some more details.
Okay.
In the sense that it's a permanent structure, or describe it to be a masonry structure, or like we did with the sanitary district, the PVC fencing, whatever materials I think is appropriate or applicable. My concern is if you strike 5, 6, and 7 in response to exploring this further, perhaps the property owner won't want to do a permanent installation beyond a fence. I don't know that answer.
Okay.
And then we don't have either in place at that point in time.
So given that, since the consideration and the working with the building owner needs to occur, is this something that would then need to be recommended for postponement until these questions can be answered and an amended recommendation can come forward? Because I hear what you're saying. You don't want to strike these down and then have it not be applicable, and then we just wasted the time, yet we don't want to pass an amendment that recommends for these landscaping and all these other things if we're not going to go that route either. So I'm not sure which direction for a motion we should go.
I don't know if Mr. Grant has an opinion on exploring this in other situations to where the concern has been around the generator enclosure. What have we done in other situations?
Well, so I was going to ask, if the public hearing is closed, can I?
You can still answer.
Okay,
yeah.
Just want to make sure.
Yeah.
So, like I said, Verizon does this at every site, and they're really pushing for this. If it comes down to, you know, whether it's a postponement or if it's not a decision that can be made to prevent the city council, or if, you know, it would involve the building owner and he wouldn't consent to it. Another last resort that has been done, it's obviously not what's proposed, but could be done, is a what they call an Appleton plug, which would be installed onto the side of the building. And this Appleton plug, you know, would obviously just be a plug, and it would be about the size of like a water spigot. And that is a generator plug. And if that's the case, then a generator would just be wheeled in emergency situations. That being said, if the generator is turned on, it will not obviously have a fencing around it. But once the power comes back,
yeah,
it can be removed. Like I said, that's a last resort by Verizon. You know, this is what they were proposing. But if that's something that can be considered, you know, to have the special use contingent on that, That's something that can be done.
It sounds like everyone's fairly, I don't want to speak, but fairly in favor of the entire project. We're like, I'd say 95% of the way there. It's just this 5% of the damn enclosure, which seems to be a popular topic.
Oh, sorry to interrupt.
No, it's okay. So, you know, the landscaping obviously just doesn't really seem all that feasible given it, but we want to make it aesthetically appealing, especially given where it's at. I would love to see something, like I said, that we've talked about quite a bit here, is some sort of more permanent-looking enclosure that would provide access while providing sound buffering while matching the building, if that's feasible.
Right.
And it sounds like that's what everyone...
Yeah. Let me try to understand something in terms of the conversation that has been going on here. But your concern with striking 5, 6, and 7 is that we will be striking basically everything without necessarily replacing it with some language that allows for some important concerns that are included in language in 5, 6, and 7. Am I getting that correctly? In other words, if we were to not necessarily just strike it out, but strike it and replace it with language that addresses those concerns, then we may have a motion that is more feasible. Now, my understanding is that we may not be able to now articulate all of those things in this meeting. In other words, is it reasonable then to ask city staff and the Verizon representatives to work out a solution that sounds like an enclosure looking like the building to which it's going to be adjacent to, and that addresses all the concerns about noise, safety, and the way this all looks? Does that sound reasonable? I know I said it.
Yes, to most of what you said. So yes, it sounds reasonable. I would put the caveat, if we are not able to do so, because we certainly can't go back to the landscaping, we certainly can't do that because of the challenges, then the alternative, what was the plug called?
Verizon refers to it as an Appleton plug.
Appleton plug?
Yes. And
so the alternative would be to not do anything and then put the Appleton plug in place. So it makes sense to do that and say we can work through this permanent insulation with a wall to attenuate noise, to provide security, to provide that ability for adjacent view sheds not to be disturbed or negatively impacted. Assuming we can come to a resolution, then the part B doesn't ever come to fruition. If we can't come to a resolution and figure out that that's cost prohibitive, the property owner doesn't want a permanent installation of a masonry structure or surround, and I'm just going to call it that for now, then we would have the ability to go back to the Appleton plug, and then there's no emergency generator on site. It's only brought in when there is an emergency. Then we're not talking about utilizing the space of the parking lot. They still have the antennas on the rooftop, and then if something happens, they bring an emergency, they run a cord, plug it into the wall, everything's lit up again.
And it would be installed on the side of the building. So
the side
and
of the
in that way, like I said, it's an alternative. That way a generator is really never on site. So it could go if the power doesn't go out, which is unrealistic, but you'd never see the generator.
How long does it take to get a generator there?
That's so Verizon really commits to their technician, you know, team. They, you know, focus on that. So although you don't really notice it, I couldn't give you exact time frame, but they have emergency teams that are deploying generators all over where they're needed in times of need because they back up every single one of their sites.
Do the other four locations have active generators, or do they have the Appleton plugs? So we have four sites in DeKalb, and if this were to go down, it would be theoretically no different than it is today, because the other three would still be
up and going,
operational. So Verizon has four.
Four existing.
Existing.
Correct.
They all have emergency backup power somehow.
Correct.
I guess the question I have is, if the power does go out in this particular site and location or citywide, do the others have on-site generators to compensate, or do they all have the Appleton plug?
So I could speak to or we'll make an assumption, the existing sites that are on towers, obviously Verizon puts their equipment shelter on the ground.
Right.
And the generator goes in the equipment shelter, so you can't hear it when it's on. But, so it would be a safe assumption that all of those have backup generators. The one that's on a rooftop, it would be a, you know, if there was a location to put it, depending on where the equipment is, I can't say for sure. But like I said, they, you know, can accommodate if it needs to be avoided to have that structure in the parking lot. Like I said, it's not preferred, but they could accommodate an Appleton plug on the building.
Do you recall the clock tower, is there?
There's a shelter.
Is there?
Yeah.
So
let me understand, you're not the architect in this firm, is that correct?
No, I work for a real estate firm, and we work hand in hand with the architect and engineering.
You know, I get the impression that, that if an architect were listening to this conversation, he would look at this picture, particularly that one, and say, and there's a chance, I don't know if this is a fact, but there's a chance he would look at that picture and say, I think we can design something that would satisfy what this commission is bringing up. And of course, we don't have that architect here. My question is it, I mean, given what we're saying here, the conversation we're having, and the feedback that he may be able to bring to his architects, is it reasonable then to ask him to go back to his architects and think about a solution together with staff that would satisfy this commission?
That's reasonable. I guess, is the Appleton plug something that would be considered?
You still have to go back for that one. I assume that can we approve the Appleton plug option here today?
Yeah.
We can?
Yeah.
Okay.
And it would be off the south side or the west side of the building, do you know? Just to kind of think
that wouldn't be determined right now. They would have to
see
where they can place it, but yeah. It won't be, you know, coming out of the building. The plug will be installed into the side of the building.
Right.
Obviously, when the generator's connected, it's going to be sitting next to the building.
Yeah, I was just trying to think the layout of that building. There really isn't much space except for that.
Can you go back to the aerial?
South side.
This is emergency.
Unless they put it on the sidewalk. Well, no, I guess there is that north side.
So it's going to be on the north side of the building?
Yeah.
No, it'll be on the...
It'd have to be on the... Well, the west side is mainly all windows, really. I mean, there's not a whole lot of... down in that bottom. I'm just thinking that building. The north side of the building is partial windows and partial... concrete or cement or whatever. Okay.
So... just to confirm, if this site goes down, the other three will still be able to operate their backup generators, the other three sites.
It would be an assumption, but knowing Verizon, yes.
Okay.
Especially the ones that are on towers or a water tank, or because in that case, they could just put their shelter on the ground.
Getting the service before a picture.
Right.
Right.
And then, like I said, the Appleton plug, let's say the power went out for 3 hours, a generator be wheeled out for 3 hours, wherever that plug is located.
Let's do the plug.
Yeah, I think that actually might be, yeah, I'm kind of leaning that way too.
Well, if I'm going to try and play telepath here, I'm guessing it's because this is more or less to boost service rather than provide it for most of these cases. So while the other ones would still have service, people would still have minimal service. There might be some people who wouldn't, at least for time being until the generator got there. I see the rationale just having the plug. I don't know, Derek. Any other thoughts on that? I like the masonry structure thing because it sounded nice and they could actually have a generator, but now we're running into this thing of cost prohibition and if the building occupant's going to be willing to do that. So,
have you talked to the bank about what their thoughts are on putting the generator on site?
No, because this was proposed to the bank as proposed right now.
Okay.
mean, this is an interesting situation because I personally don't have a strong inclination in one direction or the other. But once again, and it really comes down to your company and Verizon as well. If you are not in absolute rush for this, then the question is, why don't we give an architect the chance to look into this option? And if it is cost prohibitive, we don't know the answer to that, then we go with the plug. But it comes down in part to whether you're in a rush to get this, to move this on or not. There's some festive days coming through holidays that we may not be meeting until sometime in the future, so that's something for you to consider as well.
Right, and obviously every carrier is looking to improve their coverage yesterday, but like I alluded to, if the Appleton plug can be contingent on approval of the special use, it can be accommodated. Because like Matthew alluded to, let's say the landlord doesn't want a brick building, Verizon with the Stell thing on the roof, they're already spending well over what a usual site costs. So I just don't know what type of, whether it's the cost or...
Well, then there is... I'm sorry, go ahead.
I would suggest if it is your preference, you can do an either or. You can leave it up to the applicant to explore both. And again, you can indicate a masonry structure to meet the standards in 5, 6, and 7, provide the screening, the security, the decibel level. If you can make it their choice, if it's too cost prohibitive or another obstacle is in the way, certainly the Appleton plug has to be much more efficient, cost efficient, yeah, per se.
But and I'm thinking, what if they can't, like, what if there really isn't a place in the, on this building to put an Appleton plug? Then what's their alternative? I can't imagine that there wouldn't be, but
it seems pretty
kind of knowing that layout of that building, there could be areas that they go, well, no, can't go through there because, then what?
But I mean, my understanding is we today can move forward with the Appleton plug option.
Yeah.
Yes.
Excellent. So it sounds like there's not much controversy on everything that goes on top of the building. It may be, please tell me. But we can very well move on with the Appleton plug option, and the architect will still have an opportunity to evaluate whether they want to not go with the Appleton plug and build some structure on the parking lot.
In terms of being able to mount the Appleton plug on the side of the building, in this print here, they're running the wires underground. You can put it in a corner of the parking lot if you needed to, and they could plug in right there. I'm in favor of giving them three options. Go with the landscaping and a fence. That would be A. B would be go with the like block enclosure, a solid surface enclosure, and the third option is the Appleton plug. And then they can negotiate this out as they're trying to get this all wrapped up, so they'd be able to use any one of the three.
At what point in this process, though, does the city lose the knowledge of what they're going to do? Is there a point where, so we say, we approve this with the option of A, B, C, how are we going to know, how would the city know which, because you made a comment about the permit mm-hmm. process. So what point will the city know what option they're going to do and if that option is approvable? Like, for instance, let's say the masonry piece. Obviously, there's got to be some instruction as to
mm-hmm.
height or whatever that the city, I would assume, would provide. Or same thing with the landscaping option and fence option. So at what point does it just kind of go, okay, it's yours. You go for it now. And, but you have to do A, B, C, and then you're done.
So let me take a step back for a moment. The reason 5, 6, and 7 are in here is because our code requires that as part of a co-location installation. So all appurtenances and all accessory devices, structures, buildings, et cetera, all have these certain requirements that's in our portion of the code for co-locating. If you give an A, B, or C, or if you give an A and a B, or if you give an A or B, or if you became very specific and just gave A and said, this is how I want it to be, the way that's confirmed is at the time of the building permit. So they do not get a sign off to proceed with construction and moving forward with the electrical permits and the like until it's signed off to confirm.
This is what A is going to be.
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to make sure.
My preference moving forward, I don't want to put our building department in a situation to where they have three probably is not a laundry list, but I don't want to be in a situation to where we provide, we're okay with any of these. I think while I recognize that all three probably would likely comply with code, the first two because it addresses the decibel, the screening, the security, and the last one for the Appleton because all that part of the code goes away when the enclosure goes away. So those two are kind of hand in hand, and I think it's either this or that. But if you start going to a lengthier list, I think that becomes more challenging to your point of how does the city know, how do we confirm it? Because typically what happens is once we take this to council, if council affirms your recommendation, or they could modify it or remand it back to you, that ordinance then is put in the file of the building permit. And so that is the trackable mechanism to say if it's these eight, okay, so we need to assure that when this permit is pulled, or for that matter, the other Verizon installation on the AT&T tower, when that comes forward, those plans that were approved by you all and the city council, once construction is occurring, all those things are then checkboxed to move forward.
I will, given that, I'm happy going with one of the, then providing the two options. Do a primary option to look into some sort of material that could be built around it with, you know, a matching access door, whatever, made of, you know, manageable material, all that matches the building, same specifications, to be, you know, somewhere between 6 and 8, it'll provide all those. But if the building, you know, owner is unwilling to do that, if it's too cost prohibitive, what have you, then go with the Appleton plug. Simple. A base plan and a contingency one. Motion that thing I just said.
Okay, so Matt has put a motion forth that we would approve the recommendation of all items striking out 5, 6, 7 and replacing that with either an attachment or a masonry around the generator that would match the building that it's going to be adjacent to, unless it's cost prohibitive, and then going with the Appleton plug option, and also leaving number 8 as is. Do I have a second?
Is that all acceptable within that context of language, Doug?
I got it. Yep.
Okay.
I'll second.
Seconded by Ruling. Any discussion? There be none. Roll call.
Kroll?
Yes.
Katz?
Yes.
Ruling?
Yes.
Castro?
Yes.
Chair Atherton?
Yes. Pass.
Motion passes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For your patience in explaining all this to us. Appreciate
Thank you very much.
Okay, and we have a workshop under considerations regarding electronic digital signs. And I will turn that over to Derek.
Okay. Seems like signs are something we do every 3 years, so looking back at the calendar, we were due for this conversation. Before you tonight is a request that is being brought forward by city staff. And this is specific to electronic changeable copy signs or message boards. In past discussions, you kind of have a history and a historical perspective going all the way back to 2001. To paraphrase and to briefly give you a synopsis, in 2001, we allowed it. In 2005 or 6, we eliminated it. We brought it back in 2012, and we say we allow it as part of a special use permit process, and that's okay, or a PUD. Where we've come now to 2015 is the technology keeps evolving, and the cost associated with changeable copy signs has certainly come down, and the most recent one I can think of that we approved as a group was the special use permit for the NB&T building on Lincoln Highway. And if you remember when we had that discussion, that was certainly a larger sign, and we were quite specific of the types of messages, whether or not the intensity was the light emittance or energy, how bright it was, if you will, how frequent the message could change, that there was no flashing or blinking. And so this is a technology that is moving forward that tonight wanted to bring it back for your consideration. And just thinking outside the box and trying to understand if this is something that the Planning and Zoning Commission believes that this is a technology that we should continue to embrace. Should we continue with the methods that we have in place, or should we explore, as staff mentions in here, currently using a ground sign for a single tenant as the example. I'll pick on the most recent applicant, Culver's, when they have the message board. So we allow a sign to be 10 feet tall, 50 square feet in area, and of that 50 square feet, 18 square feet of that can be changeable copy. And up to this point in time, the code currently reads that that changeable copy portion needs to be manually changed. Meaning you slide the letters in, you slide the letters out. And so you saw McDonald's come in with that request, Culver's with that request. We're wondering at this point in time, does it make sense for that same example to allow for businesses either via a special use permit to consider these conditions and requirements, or by right, if we establish these requirements ahead of time, to allow for 18 square feet, for example, of that ground sign to be of an electronic changeable copy portion. So instead of manually changing the letters in and out, can you electronically do that? And so some of the things that were discussed in the past, you know, if our climate was different, certainly the arguments could be laid differently, I guess. The thought process always goes back to in the wintertime when there's 3 feet of snow piled up around, or the 8 or 9 feet that we anticipated seeing on top of the bank building. Someone's trucking out there with letters and standing in a snowbank, or standing on a letter or a ladder, forgive me, changing those signs. This is safer. It's more energy efficient. But it comes with the argument of the con side of it too. How frequent does the message change? How bright is it? Is it a moving billboard? Is it some of those things that are described? So both sides of that coin are being presented tonight for your consideration, and wanted to have a work session and workshop with you all to kind of discuss these technologies and kind of get a barometer of we sit as a city and where you sit as a planning and zoning commission. Because ultimately, if this was something or any amendment to the UDO would require a public hearing and then adoption by the city council, of which for tonight, consideration of the signage ordinance.
So I think of recent, in the last, what, 2 years maybe, how many times have we, so I'm thinking of the National Bank building, National Bank and Trust building. Didn't we approved that as a, under a special use permit to be a digital changing, correct?
Correct.
And we gave them some lighting guidelines, I think, if I can't remember on that.
We were prescriptive in the approval.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Is there any others in the last couple of years that we've approved?
The special use or PUD?
Yeah.
The high school.
Okay, I think that was before I came on, so, okay. But that's good to know.
In 2012, we did change the ability for gasoline stations or gas stations to use electronic pricing instead of the manual changeable. So you'll see stations now continually upgrading from one to the other. We did make that amendment in 2012. And I didn't give you any additional background material deliberately to rehash those arguments on both sides of that equation. It's just something we wanted to bring up and see where the commission was.
Well, I think it's new technology, and it makes the job of operating your store a lot easier if you can do that from inside the store. Exactly. And I'm in favor of it. What I'm not in favor of is a sign that's moving.
Yeah.
And if the description that is on there keeps going and going, the person that's driving down the road, all at once is watching it, and he's not watching the cars around him, he's reading the damn sign. And that's an unsafe condition. But I'm in favor of allowing them to put up their daily special, or whatever it is that they want to get out there. To me, it doesn't matter if they got one line or four lines on it, as long as it's not moving, if it's stationary. That's the most important thing.
Yeah, and I know that was the one concern that we had with the National Bank and Trust building was, I think they wanted to talk about having like a ticker line type thing, and that was one of the pieces mm-hmm. of contention that we discussed at the time. We are in a different time, the one thing I think I notice when I go to other communities are the signs, and I'm just sitting here looking out the window, looking at these lights on this building that are those kind of white, I think they're supposed to be white, those LED lights sometimes are like way overpowering, and I know I've seen signs that have been way overpowering, and that's obviously with the light intensity that we'd have to make sure that we discuss and talk about, because some people, that is almost as bad as a moving sign, I noticed for me. So that, that would be something to think about.
And there are certainly signs that are done tastefully.
I've seen some
there are signs. Communities that take a very regimented approach to this. Some don't allow more than one change out per hour. Some say once per day. Some say once every 4 seconds. I can think of a couple signs that are not very far from here that you could make it in less than an hour's drive, and I'm not going to pick on any particular business or community, but you see those signs and they do blind you as you come up upon them because they don't have automatic dimmer switches. So the light intensity that it's supposed to operate during the daytime when the sun is out for whatever reason, if they're broken or they're not turned down, they do blind you. And then you do have the other component that you almost do get distracted. I do, that, or almost cartoony, where you're watching going, well, that was interesting, and you come back to what you're supposed to be doing and keeping your eyes on the road.
And go, what does that say?
Yeah.
Sure. So, you know, we've highlighted, I think, 8 things here that if this is something I hear consensus on, that we can set a public hearing, but I'm trying to get additional information from you, and I'll let you all speak, but how far do we want to go with this? Do we want to crawl before we walk? Do we want to walk and then run, or do we want to hit the ground running with this one?
It definitely seems like every time that there's a building that is either coming to us to be built, that's got some type of special use or ordinance that we need to approve, their signage more than none, I think, has been that they wanted to use an electronic signage, and we've had to really consider it. So it is something that is becoming more and more the norm or the asking of every time somebody builds something or redoes a building or whatever.
Sure. The high school, we said it had to be monochromatic, meaning you're not having the starburst or you're not having multiple colors. You know, a business could almost go out to a local retailer, buy a 60-inch TV, and put it right in the window. And you have a virtual sign that is movable, dynamic, crisp, clear. I don't know if that's something we want to consider, or should they just be allowed as part of a ground sign only? So again, you know, currently the code prohibits any moving sign. So the rope lights that chase, the code currently prohibits them.
Unless you get a special use, correct? They came here for a special use and we approved it, and then it would be okay.
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend a chase light to
do that.
No,
right, I'm saying it here.
But even that manual sign over at Copy Service came to us because it was moving, mm-hmm. I think, or was brought to our attention because the thing moved back and forth. Yeah, and that was, it wasn't an electronic sign, but it was moving.
Right.
Yeah.
And our temporary sign permits are 2 weeks, 6 times a year. And so that's, yeah, I remember that one coming before the commission as well.
And so could that also be something we have to think about too with this, is could somebody come or do a temporary sign that's electronic?
Perhaps. It's hard to, to me that could be a slippery slope, and I don't have a good answer because I haven't seen a community handle that well, and I haven't seen anyone really employ codes and ordinances that permit it or prohibit it. So I don't know if it's just.
So special event parking signs, let's say like for the football game, is that considered a temporary sign? And it's electronic and it's...
It's in the state highway. I mean, you start pulling all the
true.
The okay. things about it. I could go either way. Does NIU get a permit from the state to put a sign in the middle of the road saying turn right for parking? I have no idea.
Probably. But yeah, obviously not from the city.
Right.
Okay.
And that exposure is very limited. It's up for 4 hours, 5 hours. And
right.
I'm not sure what
or
the building...
Or move-in day parking or orientation
yeah.
parking or... Yeah.
That could be considered directional, so it's probably not a temporary sign. It's not depicting a commercial activity.
Okay.
But what do we think about changeable copy? LEDs. Should I bring something back? Should we set a public hearing? Consider this?
To allow, so people wouldn't have to come in, they could just put those signs in, wouldn't have to come
That's what I'm asking.
I think we should maintain some control over that.
Okay.
Same here. And I'll I'll echo a lot of what Roger said. Like, I'm all about the safety and efficiency, very basic fixed static things out on the road so people aren't screwing around out there, breaking their necks, freezing their fingers, and having to go out there every time they decide they want to have a two-for-one on the Whopper or what have you. Now, you know, we are opening Pandora's box for everybody who's on those manual processes to walk in here and get the approval for moving to an electronic marquee out front. And I've had more conversations about signage than I ever want to have in my life. We just went through that out of Kish, as you heard of, Derek. So, I'm in favor of the common sense basic things for safety and efficiency, but anything beyond that, you do have to have, you know, a bit of a hand around, otherwise people will go psycho with it. So I think it merits further conversation, but definitely for the very basic endorsement, yeah, I'm in favor of it.
In terms of the changeable copy, I heard you list off a whole addendum of different limits that different communities have. And I personally would recommend that the sign not change more frequently than once an hour. If they're going to change their special, they're not going to be changing it every 5 minutes. And they sure as heck ought to be able to plan ahead so that they can get it done within an hourly cycle.
Okay.
If anything, my only two pennies on this is I support this conversation and the content of this conversation. The only one thing I would add is that it is always convenient and kind of instructive to get to learn a little bit about what other communities have done with respect to these things. I think it would give us an idea of what else other people have thought about, and it may add to this conversation as well. So that, in other words, this is a good start of this topic. I don't think we're going to see the end today. I wouldn't want to see the end today.
Very good. I have a good handle. Okay. That's perfect. Thank you.
Future considerations?
We're pretty open right now. We, looking at the calendar, your next scheduled meeting is Veterans Day, November 11th. That's your second Wednesday of the month.
That is before Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
And then the next one would be then the next one would be the Wednesday before Thanksgiving.
Yeah, 11th.
Right?
So that would be the 25th. And what we have right now is we have one request for a variance that, in all likelihood, because of the holidays, will come before you in December. Quorum has always been a challenge right before Thanksgiving. People leave town. And then the other one that's typically a challenge is the second meeting in December. So I shoot for one for each month. If we have to have a special meeting in November, I'll let you all know. But I don't want to sit here and say that we're going to meet on Veterans Day because I don't know what what liabilities I would have to say that we have to meet on a holiday, first and foremost. And the other one is I don't necessarily want to ask you to come out the night before Thanksgiving either. But we do have one request that's been submitted. It's for a variance for a garage.
So if just
in all likelihood, it'll be December.
So we would more than likely have, so the option in December is the 9th?
It'd be the 9th, yeah.
Okay. And not the 23rd, hopefully.
Yeah.
Okay. If we had to do a special meeting in December, just a note, November.
Well, let me ask this. Who will be around November 25th?
Me.
Maybe. Who won't be here? Let me rephrase the question. Okay.
I'd rather do the 25th than the 18th, sorry.
Okay.
So, and I have a football game.
All right. I will let you know. And I'll go ahead, it'll be December, but
okay.
I will talk to the petitioner and see.
Okay.
Okay.
Anything else? Except a motion maybe to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
So moved by Kroll, second by Castro. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed, same sign. We're adjourned. Thank you.